You persevered and kept the memory of Canada's first and only Black Battalion alive, Number 2 Construction Battalion. We are here to accept responsibility for mistakes of the past and to pledge ourselves to working every day to build a better future. Aujourd'hui, c'est une journée historique. Et je suis heureux de voir les descendants, mais je suis aussi heureux de voir tellement de jeunes ici présents aujourd'hui, y compris mon fils Xavier. Among the most selfless things a person can do is stand up and volunteer to fight for their country, to risk your life, to defend your values and your loved ones is an act of extraordinary bravery, of honor, of sacrifice, of loyalty. When the First World War broke out in Europe and Canada joined the fight, men from across the country flocked to enlist. Among those brave volunteers were hundreds of young Black men, eager to serve, who loved Canada and were ready to take up arms to defend King and country. They were willing and able patriots who wanted to serve. Des centaines de jeunes hommes venant des communautés noires voulaient servir leur pays et protéger la liberté qui nous est chère. Ils voulaient lutter avec honneur contre la tyrannie et l'oppression. Mais presque tous les volontaires venant des communautés noires se sont vus refuser l'honneur de servir leur pays. In repeated acts of discrimination and racism, almost every single Black volunteer was turned away and denied the honor of serving their country. In one instance, a group of 50 Black volunteers journeyed from Sydney to New Glasgow by train and waited all day at the recruiting office, only to be told that this was a white man's war. Those recruiters did not see men willing to fight for our collective freedom. They only saw the color of their skin. Back then, there were unwritten laws of segregation, but some were more explicit. In 1910, when the Naval Service of Canada was founded, its recruitment practices excluded non-white members. And while there was no official policy for the Canadian Expeditionary Forces, it was left up to commanding officers who repeatedly turned Black volunteers away. These shameful, discriminatory practices did not go unnoticed by the public. Letters came from across the country demanding to know why Black men could not enlist. In 1915, George Morton from Halifax, from Hamilton, wrote the Minister of Militia and Defense to speak out on behalf of his fellow Black citizens. I quote, "They think they should be permitted, in common with other peoples, to perform their part and do their share in this great conflict." He stated that Black men wanted to work out their own destiny and were anxious to serve in this critical crisis in the country's history. What more devotion to country could we have asked for? And yet, senior military leadership at the time continued to turn a deaf ear. How quickly the military leadership of the day had forgotten the history of Black soldiers. For over a century, Black soldiers had sacrificed so much to serve this place they called home. Durant la guerre de 1812, les soldats noirs ont défendu le Haut-Canada. En 1859, William Edward Hall, le fils d'anciens esclaves, a été l'un des premiers Canadiens à recevoir la Croix de Victoria pour sa bravoure. In 1861, the Victoria Rifle Pioneers Corps became the first authorized military force in Western Canada and was comprised entirely of black men who had come to British Columbia to escape racial persecution down south. By the time of the First World War, Canada already had a long history of loyal black military service. But in 1916, a major general took it upon himself to write a memo that disparaged the loyalty and combat capabilities of black men. This is what systemic racism and anti-black hate does. It suppresses the truth. It tries to rewrite history under false narratives. It buries the bravery, humanity, and common cause we share. But human nature shows us again and again that people will always find a way to stand up and demand their dignity. And the black men who wanted to serve never gave up. Le racisme systémique et la haine envers les communautés noires contribuent à supprimer la vérité. Mais la nature humaine nous a montré plusieurs fois que les gens trouveront toujours le moyen de se lever et de réclamer leur dignité. You see, 2 years after the war began, black men were finally permitted to form their own battalion, Number 2 Construction Battalion, Canada's first and only black battalion. While many members were from around here in Nova Scotia, black men and boys traveled from across the country to enlist. Two sons of the famous cowboy John Ware, Arthur and William, came all the way from the family's Calgary homestead. Environ 600 patriotes de tout le pays sont venus ici, à Truro, pour recevoir un entraînement. Ils ont fièrement revêtu l'uniforme du corps expéditionnaire canadien après 2 ans de refus. Mais ils n'ont jamais eu les mêmes possibilités ni le même soutien que leurs homologues blancs. When these black men had answered the call of duty, they had dreamt of fighting on the front lines. But instead, they were deployed to Europe as a labor unit. They had to sail on a separate ship and were sent to the Jura Mountains of southeastern France, where they joined the Canadian Forestry Corps. They did grueling work, and their contributions were invaluable to the war effort. The lumber they cut lined the trenches on the front lines, became railway ties, and was even used in aircraft. Thanks to their faithful and disciplined work, the mills produced double the lumber of other comparable units. But still, they had to live in segregated camps and without proper medical care, rations, or equipment. 23 members of the battalion died in Europe, their lives lost while serving their country. And when the war was over and the battalion came home, the living were never given the hero's welcome they deserved. À leur retour, les membres du 2e bataillon de construction n'ont jamais reçu l'accueil en héros qu'ils méritaient. In the poem we just heard, Black Soldier's Lament by Captain George Borden, the opening lines are haunting. The bugle called, and forth we went to serve the crown, our backs far bent, and build whate'er that must be done, but ne'er to fire an angry gun. No heroes we, nay, not one. That last line, how could they not be seen as heroes? As a country, we failed to recognize their contributions for what they were. Their backbreaking work, their sacrifice, their very willingness to put their country before their self. The Great War was won at the hands of every soul that served. We owe these men, these brave black men, so much. Je suis ici aujourd'hui afin d'offrir les excuses du gouvernement du Canada pour la façon horrible dont ces patriotes ont été traités. I am here today to offer the government of Canada's official apology for the appalling way these patriots were treated. For the overt racism of turning black volunteers away when they offered to sacrifice their lives for all, we are sorry. For not letting black service members fight alongside their white compatriots, for denying members of No. 2 Construction Battalion the care and support they deserved, we are sorry. For failing to honor and commemorate the contributions of the members of No. 2 Construction Battalion and their descendants, for the blatant anti-black hate and systemic racism that denied these men dignity in life and in death, we are sorry. On ne peut pas changer le passé, mais on doit tous saisir les occasions d'apprendre de nos erreurs. Malheureusement, on sait qu'un trop grand nombre de membres des Forces armées canadiennes sont encore confrontés au racisme systémique et à la discrimination, y compris le racisme envers les communautés noires. We are committed to meaningful change where the dignity of all service members in the Canadian Armed Forces is upheld. Where everyone is welcome, where everyone can rise through the ranks, where everyone has opportunities to distinguish themselves. We cannot and we will not ever let what happened to No. 2 Construction Battalion happen again in ways large or small. And we cannot let the service of any member of our forces ever be overlooked or forgotten. Today, very little would be known of the battalion's legacy if it weren't for the efforts of their steadfast descendants, relentless historians, and black leaders. I want to, again, thank Russell Gross and all of those at the Black Cultural Center for Nova Scotia for their work to research and preserve the memory of No. 2 Construction Battalion. I also want to particularly thank former Member of Parliament for Halifax West, Gordon Earle, for his dedication to commemorating the battalion. And there are two other names that need mention, of names who are no longer with us. First, Senator Calvin Ruck, who devoted himself to documenting Canada's Black military history and sharing the stories of the members of Number 2, including by publishing a book on the men. And Captain George Borden, who was a descendant of serving members and served in the military himself. Captain Borden was a ceaseless advocate of the battalion who also wrote that beautiful poem we heard earlier. I also want to acknowledge among all the various descendants and family members, Audrey Paris, who is the oldest direct descendant. Her father, Sheldon Paris, served in Number 2. Audrey can't be here with us today, but I know is watching from Toronto. Thank you. Over the past few decades, efforts have been made to recognize the battalion, including exhibitions, publications, Parks Canada events, and a stamp. Well, today, we are announcing that next year, during Black History Month, the Royal Canadian Mint will release a pure silver collector coin honoring Number 2 Construction Battalion, which will allow Canadians, no matter where they live, to be part of remembering this extraordinary legacy. L'année prochaine, pendant le mois de l'histoire des Noirs, la monnaie royale canadienne va émettre une pièce de collection en argent pur, en l'honneur du 2e bataillon de construction, pour permettre aux Canadiens de tout le pays de participer à la commémoration de son héritage. Aujourd'hui, j'espère que tous les Canadiens vont faire des recherches sur nos histoires non écrites et non racontées. Il y a des histoires comme celle du 2e bataillon qui nous montrent que la force et la résilience de notre humanité commune ne se résument pas à la couleur de notre peau. All members of the Canadian Armed Forces fight under the same flag. Our flag may have changed since the First World War, but what we stand for never has. Freedom, peace, justice, fairness, and hope. This is the promise of Canada. And while we still have work to do, this should always be what we fight for at home and around the world. To the memory of these Black soldiers, we would like to say, today we see you and we honor you. And to their descendants, we hope you see yourselves as you are, heirs to the memory of true Canadian heroes.